Started on the CD they had playing, and it's one of my favorite songs, man. And telling you, man, we serve a good God, amen. The God that never leaves us nor forsakes us, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God's good. He's good. Today, mom and dad just kind of hit on what the Lord has put on my heart to share this morning, and they kind of touched on it a little bit with some of the sayings and some of the things that they said, and you know, I my heart is to be led by the Holy Spirit, man. Yeah. And I know this, I've learned this a while back, that my life is not my own.
Yeah.
And that even the ministry that God's called us to be in, you to be in, the ministry He called you to be in, the ministry He's called me to be in, it's not even for us.
Yeah.
It's not. It's for people. And, you know, I don't identify myself with, I don't want to get too deep to that because I don't even fully understand that really, but I don't allow me personally, Mike Pursell, who I am, I don't allow who I am dictate who I am in ministry. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I don't know if that, you know. I don't let my head get wrapped up in what God uses me to do. Does that make sense? There's nothing wrong with bragging about God. There's nothing wrong with bragging about what He's done. You know, maybe sharing with somebody, hey, you know, the Lord spoke to me one time about this person's kidneys, and I told them that they needed healing their kidneys, and it was right, and God healed them. There's nothing wrong with explaining to people or telling stories to people about how God has used you to help folks and all that, because sometimes God wants us to, He'll bring us to people to identify with them. Maybe something they're going through at that time, you can connect with them. You know, like people that are going through cancer, I understand that to a point. I can understand kind of what's going on in their mind and maybe a little bit in their bodies and stuff like that. So you can kind of connect with that, and then you can kind of share with them what the Lord did to you and through you and how He healed you and things like that. So there's nothing wrong with that, but really who you are in ministry, what God has called you, that gift, that anointing that He's put on your life, whatever that is, that's really for the service of other people.
Right.
Now, God will bless you as you obey Him. Amen. The Word's full of obedience. Scriptures talks about if you're obedient to God, He'll bless you, He'll favor you, He'll use you, He'll anoint you, all that good stuff. He'll bless your family, your descendants, your offspring. The Bible talks about all that. But see, we can't let ourselves get so wrapped up in how powerfully God uses us that it changes our mind and messes us all up when we get into all this conceitedness and haughtiness and all this stuff. Amen? Thank you, Lord, for allowing me to share that today. That just came out of my spirit. Amen? But see, I know that I need help.
Right.
I know that I need free. I need to be set free in areas. I know that I'm a work in progress. I know that God is dealing with me and helping me. And the awesome thing about God is, now this is where I wanted to get to today. This is what I want to focus on today. Sometimes, you know, I'll get up here and just like be kind of just a shotgun sermon, we call them. It's like just you fire that shotgun and those pellets just go everywhere. You know what I mean? And God kind of touches people and speaks to people in different areas of their life. And it's called a shotgun sermon sometimes. But today, I really feel like the Lord wants me to hone in on one specific thing. And what I want to talk about today, and what I want us to focus on today, is our relationship with the Lord.
Yeah.
Our one-on-one relationship with the Lord. I'm not talking about our relationship with the Lord through our parents or our grandparents or our husband or our wife or whatever. I want to talk today about your personal relationship with the Lord and how important that is today. Amen?
Yeah.
So we're going to go over to Psalms 25. Excuse me if I cough every once in a while. I'm healed, and I didn't die last week. Glory to God. God healed me, restored me, got me through. Praise God. Hallelujah. But every once in a while, I kind of get that little tickle. You know what I'm talking about? But I'm good. I've been shoving halls in my mouth 2 weeks, and actually I'm kind of tired of tasting halls. That's just like the grossest thing after a while. You gotta brush your teeth about 20 times a day. It's just the way it makes your mouth taste. Can I get an amen on that one? So Psalms 25. Look here at, let's look here at verse 1. Psalms 25, verse 1. It says, "To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. Oh my God, I trust in you. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Indeed, let no one who waits on you be ashamed. Let those be ashamed who deal treacherously without cause." Now you're going to see the word "wait." You're going to see the word "sitting before the Lord." You're going to see that theme strong in these verses here that we're going to read. So just listen to that. Verse 4. This is a prayer, obviously. Verse 4 says, "Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. On you I will wait all the day. Remember, O Lord, your tender mercies and your loving kindness. For they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to your mercy, remember me. For your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore he teaches sinners in the way. The humble he guides in justice, and the humble he teaches his way. All the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth to such as keep his covenant and his testimonies. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my iniquity, for it is great. Who is the man that fears the Lord? Him shall he teach in his way he chooses. He himself shall dwell in prosperity, and his descendants shall inherit the earth." Amen. Now listen to this. "The secret of the Lord is with those who fear him, and he who show them his covenant. My eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he shall pluck or bring me out my feet or bring out my feet out of the net." Now, that verse 14 there, "The secret of the Lord is with those who fear him."
Yeah.
See, God only really reveals his secrets to the ones that are close to him in relationship. God only reveals his secrets. God only reveals his counsel to the ones that are close to him in relationship.
Wow. That's right.
Let that get in you strong. I know some of us have got a hold of this maybe and all that, but I don't care how long you've been a Christian, how strong you are in the Word and all that, your desire daily should be with the Father.
Yes.
It really should if you're following Him.
Yes.
Like you should be. It really should. This isn't a condemnation message today. This is a good message today. This is a glorious. This is a hopeful. This is an awesome. This is the way that you can have victory in your life by being close to your Father. And I was listening to Todd Bentley last night. He was ministering at a meeting he was at. It was on the internet, and I was listening to it. And I heard him say something that really kind of answered a question for me that I had kind of wondered about for years. And he was talking about intercessory prayer. And he was talking about, and I know that some folks are called, that's their calling, and that's just how God uses them. I know several that are in this building this morning, and every once in a while, you know, intercession will even come on me or come on other folks. But I heard him say this last night. He said, "I'm not an intercessor. I would rather just lay on my back or sit down on my rear end in the presence of the Lord and just sit there."
Yeah,
and that answered the question, because there was times in my life where I'm thinking, man, Lord, you know, I want to, you know, sometimes, you know, I feel, man, am I not praying enough? Am I not saying enough? Am I not doing enough?
Yes.
You know, you think that way, you know, and you know, you hang around this wild lady right here for a while, and you kind of look at your prayer life and go, gosh, I'm just kind of like, you know, boring, you know? You start to compare, you know, yourself to people. Anybody in here ever compare yourself to somebody? You know, you kind of think, well, you know, I do that a lot. And God's helping me with that. But you know, he said this, not everybody's called to be an intercessor. Not everybody's a prophet. Not everybody's a pastor. You know, not everybody's a teacher, you know. You have your niche. You have that call. God's given you a specific calling, and it's a good calling because it's from God.
Amen.
And it's a glorious calling because it's from God. And it will bring people out of hell because it is from God. It'll bring deliverance to people's lives. It'll bring healing to people's lives because it's from God. God is love. And listen, He won't function in anything if the motive isn't love.
Amen.
Once I learned to yield over to compassion for people, I started seeing more healings manifest in people's lives. Because it's the love of God that comes through you. I watched a man one time, I forget his name, he's a healing evangelist. I watched him. There was a boy that was totally crippled. He was standing in the second row of this church. And I don't know what he had. He had some kind of bone disease or something. I don't know, but he was really crippled. But everything was contorted. His arms, his feet, his legs, his hands, everything. And he couldn't even, I mean, he really couldn't walk unless someone was holding him or something. He was sitting down. And I saw this man begin to minister to him. And he wasn't really saying anything. He was just kind of like letting the Lord just love on him. It was just one of those kind of quiet times. And then all of a sudden, I saw the man go up and he grabbed the boy. He stood the boy up and he grabbed him. And he only did was hug him. Just hugging. And the man was just weeping. The minister was just weeping. Just hugging him. And all of a sudden, he let go of that boy and he stepped back. And when he did, the boy's body totally straightened out. The boy began to jump and run across the congregation. And you should have saw the place that they were in. Just erupt. Like I have never seen
Amen.
God healed that boy through compassion. Through weeping and love. The love of the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. So see, when you get close to the Lord, when you sit with Him, when you turn everything off and you choose, kids, leave me alone. Wife, leave me alone. Chihuahuas, leave me alone. Going in here for half hour or however long. I'm just going to sit in the peace of the Lord.
Amen.
Now, this isn't some new heavy revelation. This isn't something God woke me up at 2:30 in the morning and showed me. This is just the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Those scriptures we just read right there, that right there, there's tons of scriptures that talk about relationship with the Father. He will show, He will speak His secrets to you in His counsel, in His chambers. In relationship.
Yes.
It's like Moses. Moses told the Lord, I am not going anywhere, God, without your presence.
Yes.
That's it.
Guys, I'm going to tell you. I've put this to the test of my life. I've had no other choice. Sometimes God don't really give you a choice. And I'll say, let me rephrase that. You know inside.
Right.
You don't have any other choice but to follow Him. You know
right.
it.
Right.
Know it.
Exactly.
There's nothing you can... You can't do... There's sometimes you can't do anything about anything. He's the only one that can do it.
Right.
Thank you.
I'd say that's most of our life, really, to be honest with you. I knew when they said I had leukemia, I knew that I couldn't will it out. I couldn't pay enough money to get it out.
Right.
I couldn't do enough jumping jacks and eat enough greens and do all this to get it out.
Right.
That's all good. That's fine. But I knew it had to be God.
That's
all I had. And that's a good thing. That's all we have. If that's all we have, what else? What else? Who else?
Nobody.
If you lose everything, you'll never lose them. I've heard my dad say, if I lose my house, if we lose this church, if I lose my cars, if I have to live in a tent, and you know, somewhere out in the middle of nowhere, something like that, God's still with me, and God will sure restore back to me everything He needs to restore. Because He's a faithful God. What that says to me is, there ain't no one else I can trust but Him. He'll do everything He needs to do in my life.
Amen.
Follow Him. You know what one of the two biggest words that really mess with you are? What if? When you usually hear the word what if, what comes right after that?
Fear.
I'm learning that what if is just as good as toilet paper. I'm weird, man. I don't know where I get some of this stuff, but sometimes that's just the way you gotta look at stuff, man. And that's putting it nicely. You know, it's just because I'm in church, amen, and I have to be nice. Praise God. What if? What if?
Come on.
Who cares? You're going to die, believer. Thanks for lying to me. Now I know I'm going to live because everything you say is a lie. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Hit the nail on the head.
That's how we got to look at it, because it's the truth.
Yep.
Father of lies. Beelzebub. Father of the flies.
Yeah.
What do you do with flies? You swat them, man. They know you. They know you. You just smack them.
Right.
A lie fly. Yesterday morning, I was sitting at home. Last Sunday morning, I was sitting at home and I was watching the service on live. And Dad was preaching, and that was a good word. And I heard the Lord say this, and when He said this to me, I knew it wasn't just for me, but I knew it was for others, and He wanted me to share it eventually. It just came back to me while I was talking about this. But I heard this come out of me as I was watching the service. I heard myself say this. This year, I'm free from fear. This year, I'm free from fear. And as you go on this year, there's a process that God will take you through and help deliver you fully from the fear that have grown roots in your life. I'm watching Him do it to you right now as I speak, guys. And He'll show you, now listen, He'll show you something. There's something that you've either opened the door in your life out of ignorance in the past, or a way you were taught, or things that were said over you, or even things that you've said, but there's always a door that usually is open to the enemy to come in to grab your mind and to develop those roots that are on the inside of you that are fear. That doesn't happen. Now, I can't speak for everybody in here, but I know that God, if you're serious about this, because listen, I've talked to a lot of people lately that the devil is trying to mess with them with fear and no peace, anxiety, depression, oppression, all this kind of stuff, anxiety, all this stuff has been coming on people, been talking to people, and it's nothing but an attack from the devil. But I'm going to tell you right now that we can pray for you, but you have got to get before the Lord, and you've got to ask Him, what is it that's causing this? Because this is not of you, God. This is of the enemy, and I am tired of it. And you've got to come against the devil, and you've got to let the Lord speak to you and show you what is allowing this in your life.
That is a good word. Amen. Good word.
Now, I can't stand up here and talk because I don't have all day, but listen.
That's Paul.
There's two areas that He showed me in my life, because I've been seeking Him for months about this.
Yeah.
I would have panic come on me so strong, I would hyperventilate and pass out. There's nothing wrong with me. I'm as healthy can be. But fear would grab me by the throat. I don't know how else to explain it. It would turn me into another person. It was demonic. And I finally got to the point several months back that I've had it with it. And of course, talking with Dad and with other folks that have dealt with stuff like this, and you can glean from them and get some advice, and you know, even spiritually they can help you out and stuff like that. But when it comes down to it, really, you've got to get before the Lord.
Yeah.
You've got to do whatever it takes to find out what it is that's causing that. We know it's an attack, all that, but there's a reason.
Right.
And I sought God for a few months about it, and I would ask the Lord throughout the day when I'd feel that, come on. Of course, I would rebuke it. I would stand against it. I'd tell it to go in the name of Jesus. Spirit of fear. God has not given me a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. I would use the scriptures. I would combat the devil with the word. I would do all that stuff, do what I knew to do. I would stand where I needed to stand. I understood all that. But then finally, God made it plain to me. By talking to me, there was two areas in my life that was opening the door to the enemy. And I understood what he was talking about when he spoke to me those two things.
Amen.
And I began to, on purpose, change those things.
Amen.
When the enemy would try to attack my mind with that, I would refuse and say no. And let me tell you, it wasn't a long knockout, drag-out fight either with him. It was no.
Right.
And I just keep going about doing what I'm doing. Exactly. The thought would come back. Nope. Not like that anymore.
Yeah.
I'm not going to use my mouth like that anymore.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say that anymore. I'm not going to agree with the enemy in that anymore.
Yeah.
One of the things, I won't tell you both because the other one's personal, but one of them to me was my mouth. My words.
Yeah.
He said that's one of the biggest ways that you open the door to the devil is with your mouth.
Yeah.
And you begin to talk to me. You know what, folks? I've been taught this all my life.
Yeah.
Literally. 42 years old, I've been taught your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth, your mouth. What are you saying? Yeah. What are you in agreement with? What are you... But you know, until you make a decision to do it, you'll never do it.
Right.
Yeah, what a heavy revelation that is. Wow. I can write a book on that. But until you hear and you do personal, right? And see, listen, I would have never known all that until I got that relationship. You get the secret counsel in the relationship.
Right.
You look at Abraham. Mom and Dad mentioned Abraham earlier. You look at Abraham. He would have never been who he was if he wasn't close to God. And get instructions from God.
Yes!
He would have never been that.
Amen.
And that anointing that was on Abraham's wife, at first, I mean, Sarah was like, You know, then they tried to lie to God. Well, we didn't laugh. And God says, no, you did laugh. We got there, Genesis chapter 18. You know? But that anointing that was on Abraham came on his wife eventually.
Yeah.
She believed, she received, and she conceived that child.
Right.
The promise.
Right.
Once she grabbed a hold of that, she didn't waver in that promise. That's why God performed what he did, because they received that word from the Lord.
Yeah.
But see, they wouldn't have received that word from the Lord if they didn't have close relationship.
Amen.
You know,
word.
God reveals his secret counsel in close relationship.
Yes.
That's why you read there in 14. The secret of the Lord is with those who fear him.
Yeah.
And he will show them his covenant. Secrets. Covenant.
Yeah.
Mike, you know why the devil's tormenting you in this area? Because this is where you open the door, Mike.
Right.
Oh! Lord, thank you. I didn't even see that. That's how I felt. I didn't even see that, Lord.
Yeah.
I love it when God talks to you.
Because
it's so straight to the point.
Right.
And it's so loving, and it's so full of mercy, and it's so full of power. And you take those words he says, and you say, okay, and you agree with those words, then power, then fruit is produced in your life. And what used to hinder you doesn't hinder you like it hindered you. And you feel it getting less and less Unless, as you stay in agreement with God, you feel it getting less and less and less as you stay in close relationship with your true and one Father.
Amen.
That's where deliverance comes.
Right. Good.
But you got to make a decision.
Right.
Can't waver and, you know, be wishy-washy about it. You got to make a decision that I'm going to seek God until I get the victory in this.
That's on in.
Amen.
Can't put a time limit on it. You can't say, God, if you don't, by 12 o'clock, give me the answer, forget it.
Right.
Your job is just to humble yourself, seek Him. He'll provide.
Yeah.
He'll provide the answer when He needs it. Listen, sometimes He won't show us things until we're not ready for it yet.
Right.
Yeah.
Know that for sure. Sometimes He won't do things for us because we're not ready for that yet. But there will be a point in time, there will be a season in time where He will maybe do that in our lives. Amen? Now, look at this. Look at first, let's go over to chapter 26 right there. Psalms 26. Psalms 27. I'm sorry. Now, the first half of this chapter right here, Psalms 27, the first half of this chapter is a praise. It's singing praise. It's praising God. The last half of this chapter is a prayer, okay? This chapter's not long. It's 14 verses. I'm going to read it. Now listen to this. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident.
Yes.
One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord. Now, I love how he says this right here. He says, and that last part there in verse 3. In this I will be confident.
Yeah.
And then he goes on to say, one thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Come on.
To behold the beauty of the Lord.
Mm.
Are you alive right now? Pinch yourself.
Yes.
This isn't a dream. I'm alive. I'm here right now. I'm looking at you beautiful people, and I'm here. This is a day, this is a life right now. This is your life, this is your day. Dwell in the house of the Lord.
Yep.
And you know what? It isn't talking about this building we're in.
Amen.
This is a place to be used to worship the Lord in, but it's not the house of the Lord. The temple of the Holy Ghost is you.
Yes.
It's in you. He's in you. Dwell in His, what's he saying here? I want to just dwell in your presence, God, every day.
Yes!
While I'm on this earth, and then the ages to come in eternity, I want to dwell in your presence, Lord.
Amen.
Don't wait for heaven to dwell in the presence of the Lord. Do it now.
Yes.
It's so much better.
Yes.
It's so much better than not dwelling in the presence of the Lord.
Yeah.
Man. I mean, how miserable is it when you feel fear all around you, you feel all that junk around you? It's not fun. But you can break it open by start worshiping the Lord. You can break it open by being still and knowing that He is God.
Yes.
Folks, like Pastor Tom Terry says all the time, this isn't a life that we just float around a bed of roses all the time. There is hardship sometimes. There is temptation sometimes. There is persecution sometimes. But what does the Lord say when we get persecuted? Rejoice!
Yes.
Look to me!
Yes.
I'm your fortress, I'm your shield, I'm your banner, I'm your deliverer.
Yes.
I'm your provider, I'm your protector, I'm your king.
Yes.
Yes.
Train yourself, have it become your nature to rejoice out of your heart when temptation comes, when persecution comes, when someone that hates you speaks about you or lies about you or whatever, choose to rejoice.
Yeah.
In the Lord, because that's where your hope is. My hope isn't in my dad. My hope isn't in you. My hope isn't in my wife. My hope isn't in my children. They're all wonderful. I love them all. I love everybody and all that. But my hope is in the Lord, because He's the only one that can deliver me from darkness. He's the only one that can cast the devil out of me, praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm the first one here to admit that I have issues sometimes. But I'm on the pathway of deliverance. I'm learning every day as I look to the Lord, hallelujah, that He's got me, that He's protecting me, that He's got my children, He's got my family, He's got this ministry, He's got you guys, the people I care about, friends. He's got people in their hands, hallelujah.
Yeah.
And He's my only hope. He's who I look to. Don't wait until you're in a sticky situation to cry out to God. Just cry out to God every day and love Him and thank Him and be in relationship with Him. Be in relationship.
Amen.
Be close to Him.
Amen.
You want the power of God in your life? Get close to Him.
Right.
Look what happened to Moses. God came down on that mountain, man, and visited Moses. Well, folks, I'll tell you right now, God will come down in your bedroom and visit you too.
Amen.
If you seek Him. If you want it.
Amen.
How hungry are you for it? You ever been to that point in your life where you're just so hungry for a certain restaurant, a certain burrito, a certain taco, glory to God, when you just start thinking about whatever that is, your favorite kind of food, you'll do it, and you'll drive to get it. Prophesy, hallelujah.
There you go.
How hungry are you for God? And you know what? It's not being selfish either to desire God to help you.
Yeah.
How can He use you if you don't get help first?
Exactly.
Now, He'll even use us despite of our goofiness.
Amen.
Believe me, because He's been using me for a long time and I was goofy, man. Really goofy.
Amen.
You better sit down with Jesus. Ushers, keep an eye on this one. I mean, despite our flaws and our weaknesses at times, but see, God sees where we're going. He sees who we are. He looks at us how He created us. Like I said earlier, He looks at our heart intent, our heart motive, our compassion, and our heart. That's what He uses. So see, if we're serious about following Him, as we go along in life and in this journey with Him, He begins to reveal things to us and show us that there's areas that we need to mature in or we need to grow up in and things like that. So that's a good thing. It's like my kids, I don't look at them just because they don't know a certain thing on how to do a certain thing. I don't get mad at them about that, because there was a time in my life I didn't know how to do that or understand that either. So it's just something that we've got to be taught. It's the same thing with us walking with the Lord. He knows that we don't know certain things, but He knows how to get us to that revelation of that certain thing that we're going to need for the future. So if we'll follow Him and stay in close relationship with Him, He'll lead us right into that, whatever that is He's called us to be in, and He'll work with us as we go through the tunnel of life. Amen?
Amen.
That's how good He is, praise God. He'll do it for us. Hallelujah. But it isn't selfish you asking God for something. Don't let the devil, I don't know who that is in here, but don't let the devil lie to you about that.
Right.
You're important.
Yeah.
And you're important to Him.
Right.
His heart is ever seeking to love you and to bless you and to help you.
Right.
And to minister to you. That's the kind of God He is. Amen.
Amen.
It says in verse 5. Let me suck on another disgusting hose.
Amen.
That permits better. Nah, I'll just do this one more time. I think you're right, peppermint is better. Because I had one yesterday and it helped.
You want one?
No, that's okay. I got it. Thank you. Verse 5. For in the time of trouble, He shall hide me in His pavilion. In the secret place of His tabernacle, He shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock. Glory to God. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Lord, just give Frosty another drink, Lord. Just give her blasted in the Holy Ghost, a new wine. Hallelujah. She knew we were getting to the scripture right here. Therefore, I will, not your wife, your husband, your kids, your pastor, I will offer sacrifices of joy, hallelujah, in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord, hallelujah, in his tabernacle. I will sing, I will rejoice, I will worship. Listen, we think of the word joy, we think of the word rejoicing, we think sometimes it's got to be unspeakable full of glory, just kind of moving or something like that. But did you know that you can lay flat on your back and rejoice if you need to? Rejoicing isn't so much a movement, it's part of it, but it's a heart thing. Your heart is filled with gladness. Your heart is filled with peace. Your heart is filled with joy. Your heart is filled with thanksgiving. You want to learn how to be really close to the Lord? Live in praise and thanksgiving. The Bible says that He inhabits the praises of His people. He comes down by you being humble, by you waking up. When you wake up in the morning and you say, God, I'm here to serve you today. I love you, Lord. My heart is open to you. That right there opens the pipeline to the Lord between you and Him. That right there is someone saying, God, I'm before you, and I just want to do what you called me to do, Father. I want to serve you today, love you today, follow you today. I don't know it all, but God, you do, and I'm at your hand, Lord. I yield to you. And as you go on throughout your day, and circumstances come, and pressures come, and things happen, and you just want to snap, you just want to act out, you get frustrated because you're tired, or you get aggravated because, you know, someone said something to you or something like that, and maybe even you lash out, maybe even you use your mouth to say something you shouldn't say, maybe you even act the way you shouldn't act. Well, you know what? It isn't the end of your life. All you got to do is say, God, forgive me. I thank you that you're teaching me in this. You're growing me in this. You're delivering me from this, Father God, and I'm at your hand, and I yield to you. Hallelujah. And you keep going. The biggest lie, the biggest lie in God's eyes, and the biggest thing in God's eyes that He does not like is pride. And that's opposite of humility. I can do it. I don't need your help. I don't need God. I don't need a pastor. I don't need friends that love Jesus. I'm a self-made man. Man, that's scary. That's dangerous. But people do it. But I'm praying. My heart is that those hearts that are hardened and full of pride can break before the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
My heart broke and I said yes to Him. Still a learning process, still a growing process, still a construction site. But when you let your heart be revealed before the Lord, He knows it anyways. But there's something about, you know, if you want to do it, you can get on your knees and just say, Lord, here I am. You can stand in your shower and say, Lord, here I am. You can drive down the street in your car and say, Lord, here I am. My heart's on. I want to know your secrets. I want to know your covenant. I want to know your ways. I want to know what you're doing, God. I just want to get close to you. You want to talk about deliverance in areas of struggling. You want to talk about total freedom. You start getting close to God. Your life will change, guys. It doesn't matter. Listen to me. I don't care if you've been preaching the word for 20 years. Your life changes. Those scriptures, glory to glory, those are true. We grow with God in His glory. Now, it says, where was that? Oh, yeah. Now, verse 7, this is where it turns into a prayer.
Yeah.
Hear, O Lord. He's got that worship and praise. And it says, Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, Seek my face, my heart said to you, Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me, God. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation.
Yeah.
When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me.
Amen.
Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies.
Yeah.
Do not deliver me to the will of my adversaries. For false witness have risen against me, and such as breathe out violence. I would have lost heart unless I had believed.
Yeah.
Unless I had believed.
Mm. Yes.
You would not be in here if you did not believe today.
Yeah.
I'm sure there might be some that come sometimes and don't believe. They just want to see if it's real. And that's okay. God will prove himself real. That's for sure. He slammed me to the floor several times. There was nothing I could stink and do about it either. Even when I tried to get up, I couldn't get up. The two times he did that to me, he was burning cancer out of my body.
Yeah. Yeah.
March of 2008.
Yeah.
I never forget it. I thank him for it every day.
Amen.
That's a whole other story, but that's good stuff. Verse 13. I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Now listen to verse 14. Listen to this. Wait on the Lord.
Yes.
Be of good courage.
Yes.
And he shall strengthen your heart.
Yes.
Wait, I say, on the Lord.
Amen.
Guys, the key to victorious living with the Lord is to wait on him.
Yes. Yes.
To seek him.
Amen.
Jesus' heart was to serve, not be served. Jesus' heart was to seek his Father in every area of his life.
Amen.
Even when he went through the cross, he still sat before his Father. And he allowed what his Father needed to allow to happen for us, for you, for me. But Jesus was tempted by the devil just like you are. Luke 4, you can read it. But you know what? He kept looking to his Father. When that fear comes, look to your Father. When you're a child, and you were out somewhere with your dad or your mom or something like that, and you got afraid, what did you do? You went to your parents. You ask dad for help. You ask mom for help.
Yes.
Ask your dad for help. Yes. He's your real father.
Amen.
He will come. He will visit when you ask.
Yes.
He will.
Thank you, Lord.
Wait on the Lord. I just challenge you this year. I've had the Lord speak to me about this year. I know if you've asked him about this year and things like that, I'm sure he showed some things to you too. He will. But I just really sense this year is a year of great promotion for the body of Christ.
Yeah.
I heard him say that to me. And the word promotion there, I mean like favor on the body of Christ.
Yeah.
Just stuff that stuff that's gonna fall on our lap. Like we're going to find ourselves being used by him in areas that we didn't even know he could use us in. Stuff like that is what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Stuff that we're not planning.
Right.
But just spontaneous type stuff. Suddenly type stuff. Promotion, favor type stuff.
Amen.
You're going to find, listen, some of you are going to find yourselves this year doing stuff that you never even thought you would be doing for the Lord.
Yeah.
Using you in ways you never thought. I believe that.
Yeah.
And I also believe this too, that he spoke to me and he said that because of that, what I just shared, there's going to be a lot of glory this year. Manifestations of the glory of God. Not only for your personal life and your families, but for people that God's going to use you to minister to.
Amen.
You're going to be standing talking to people in the line at Walmart or the store or your work or somewhere, and all of a sudden the glory is going to manifest. And you're going to feel it. And it's going to be so easy to do what God wants you to do for that person. That's the way I wish it was every time. That would be awesome. Or sometimes by faith, you just got to grab a hold of that person, you know. But sometimes, God, but I believe this year is going to be your promotion, favor for the body of Christ, and the year of glory. I really believe that. With everybody? We'll just come up here real quick and share. I'll let you, even though you said that about me, but I don't hold grudges. I forgive.
During service and even before church, I want to prophesy this over you.
Over the body.
Over this church, over the body. I see the glory in every proportion. I see your glory in every proportion. Oh Lord. I see breakthrough of epic proportion for you. I see breakthrough.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Now that breakthrough, thank you, Lord. That breakthrough, we hear that word so much thrown around. But here it is right here. That word breakthrough, if you will, some of you right now are going, well, I've never had breakthrough. If you will wait on the Lord, you make it part of your daily life. Until I started doing that, I just kind of floundered around and just kind of, you know, wondered why this happened. How come I didn't understand this? But when I started making that a daily part of my life, all those answers, all those questions, all that stuff started to come out and started to come forth. You want to see the epic proportions of the manifestation of the glory of God in your life and your family. You start waiting on Him. Now that word that Tammy just sung out right there, that was prophetic. That was basically what I said prophetically by saying she sung that out. And that is true. I really know, I know that I know that I know. That favor, that promotion, and that glory. See, because you can't have favor or promotion without the glory of God anyhow. But that is going to come on us. If you're hungry for it, you want it, and you yield it to Him.
Amen. Yes.
Moses said, I will not go anywhere without you, God, without your presence. I will not go anywhere without your presence. Thank you. Key to our victorious living is to wait on you, to seek you, to know you, to get close to you. Just like the apostles in John 15. You know what? Turn over there real quick. And I'm going to wrap it up. Thank you, Lord, for your glory. Show us your glory, Lord. John 15, show us your glory. Show us your glory. John 15, look at verse 14, what Jesus says right here. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer, verse 15, no longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends.
Yeah.
For all things that I heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain. That whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you. These things I command you, that you love one another. First of all, Jesus hasn't called you a servant, he's called you a friend.
Yeah. That's
you ever have that one friend that you know? I'm not talking about family.
Yeah.
I'm talking about that one friend that's not blood. That you know you can call at any moment of the day.
Yeah.
Any time of night. And say, I'm having this personal problem. I'm struggling. I'm dealing. This is going on. And you know that you know that you know that they have you in prayer. They have you in confidence. They have you that they'll keep whatever you share to themselves. You know, you ever had that one friend? Think about that person multiplied by a million of who Jesus is.
Thank you, Lord.
And who the Father is.
So thankful.
Thank you. Didn't call you a servant. He called you a friend. I don't care if I didn't have any friends on this earth, as long as I have Jesus.
Amen.
He's my friend. He'll take care of everything I need taken care of. He'll do more than a natural human friend on this earth can do.
Amen.
That you should bear fruit. You bear fruit by obedience. You bear fruit by being obedient to the Father. You bear fruit by hearing what the Father's saying, and you do what the Father tells you to do. That's how you bear fruit. And the fruit remains. It doesn't die. It dries up. But it remains. Those words you said to somebody a year ago, those words you said to somebody last week, and God used you to say to them, and maybe you didn't even know God was using you to say to them, and it blessed them, healed them, and helped them,
yeah.
That fruit won't die.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Right.
Because it comes from the throne of God.
Right.
Hear what heaven is saying in the throne room.
Yeah.
How do I do that? Lord, I want to enter into the throne room, Lord. Lord, I praise you. I seek you. I look to you. I love you. Sometimes he'll allow you to hear what's going on.